TARDIS, and welcome to Mr. TARDIS Reviews, where I seem to change the camera angle every other week. Now, do you remember the 2007 story Utopia?
The reason I make this comparison is because that episode had a big twist ending and a cliffhanger which shook everything up, just like this episode does. As a result, nearly every review I've seen of this episode basically says, 5 stars, oh my god, that twist ending was amazing! Guys, you do realise that there was an episode in here somewhere, right? But the difference between Utopia and The Almost People is that Utopia was a great story, filled with rich, interesting characters, great performances, and a good production. This episode, however, is an absolute mess. Okay, continuing on from last week's episode with the reveal of the Ganger Doctor, it doesn't waste any time getting the momentum going.
Would you like a jelly, baby?
Tom Baker?
Okay, so once the Ganger Doctor has stabilised, the plot concerns the two factions, one with the humans and the other with the Biffa Nautical Gangplankers. As we all know, this episode is trying to establish an emotional conflict. Could the Gangers potentially be real people? Last week I had a big criticism with the story, but I didn't talk about it in my review, because I was hoping it would be explained and resolved this week. But this Ganger concept shot itself in the foot from the very, very start. What this two-parter has established is that whenever one of these flesh copies is killed, then it just dissolves, and whoever was in control in the harness regains control of their original body. Have you ever seen Avatar? Oh wait, of course you have. Who hasn't seen Avatar? Well, it's a similar concept. The humans inhabit and take control over bodies to do their work, or empty vessels in a way. But what this story is trying to get across is that these Gangers could be considered equal. No. That doesn't work. The Gangers are empty vessels that are controlled by the humans when they're in the harness. So whenever one is killed, it just becomes a lump of flesh and dissolves. This is established. Then, when the solar tsunami takes place, the Gangers think they are real people, and that's where the emotional conflict works. But the characters keep trying to pretend that the flesh that has been used before the tsunami should also be considered equal.
No, I'm sorry, but because of what you established, that cannot work. If that's like feeling sorry for a brick at a construction site because you broke it.
The focus should have just been on the new conscious Gangers, but the characters keep talking about the previous Gangers that were killed, and those previous Gangers are controlled and actually not sentient in any way. I know I'm rambling on about this, but we are being asked to care about something which has been established as something not unlike Moss, but instead a lot of screen time is devoted to scenes like this.
And there's one question in those eyes. Why?
And then they are destroyed and they feel death and all they can say is why?
The reason I'm annoyed at this particular problem is because it takes up so much screen time. Screen time that could have been used to make the characters, well, characters.
Simply put, all of these characters are lifeless, boring, and have no personality. What do we learn about this guy in this 90-minute story? He has a kid. And it's the kid's birthday. What can you tell me about Buzzer, other than the fact that he has a sense of humour? What can you tell me about Miranda, other than the fact that she's a bitch with a blood clot? And what can you tell me about Jennifer? Her character literally changes from scene to scene. The scared Ganger who kissed and adored Rory turned on him at the drop of a hat and spends this whole episode trying to kill everyone. This episode is full of unintentionally funny moments. That scene with the Jennifer Ganger melting, I cannot take it seriously because of the mouth. Look at that. That's fucking hilarious. This guy, who is so underdeveloped that I can't even remember his name's big emotional journey of this story, reaches its peak with this scene, and it's ruined by quite possibly one of the worst child actors I have ever seen in my entire life. And no, I am not exaggerating.
I think you want to speak to Dad.
Yes.
Daddy. Where's my daddy? When are you coming home?
Daddy's coming home today, Adam.
Yay!
What can I add to that? Does he look excited for his birthday? Does he look like he's missing his dad?
Why does he have to keep playing with his shirt? What the hell is the deal with those massive slippers? Seriously, one of those things is the size of his head. Couldn't this scene have been done through just phones? The hologram seems a bit excessive, and just hearing the kid's voice through a phone probably would have been more powerful. Instead of being moved or touched by this already underdeveloped aspect of the episode, that child actor pretty much destroys any hope of this scene being effective. Also, while I'm on the subject of this father-son relationship, and I use that term loosely, but am I the only one who thinks that the whole idea of the gangers being emotionally weaker than the humans completely ruins the idea of them being equal and destroys the entire concept of the story? I thought the whole dilemma was that these two factions are supposed to be equal, but that aspect is completely destroyed when the ganger expresses emotional weakness, but then the plot just carries on as if they're still equal. What about the shoes concept? While I thought it was actually a stroke of genius that a doctorly moment in last week's episode when he lost the shoes actually became a central part of the plot in this episode, it's handled incredibly poorly. Why? Because it doesn't make any sense. Okay, so at some point the Doctor and Ganger Doctor swap shoes. That would make sense, except the Ganger Doctor senses the pain of the other gangers, which is the entire point of the why scene. But then it's established at the end that the actual Doctor knows about his death. The Ganger Doctor was putting the phone call on delay because he knew about it later, so it must have been the actual Doctor who spoke to Amy in private. But that can't have been the actual Doctor, because it was the ganger who felt the emotions of the other gangers. So does that mean that the actual Doctor can feel gangers' emotions? If so, why can't anybody else? And why would he feel it stronger than the actual ganger? It's a tacked-on plot twist that doesn't make any sense to begin with, but by the looks of it, Amy telling the Doctor about his death is about to become really important. So not only does the plot twist not make any sense, but it's about to become a key component in future episodes. That's like building a house on top of quicksand. When the Miranda ganger calls for the shuttle, she makes her request and then they ask for the code word. Shouldn't they ask for the code word first? Oh, and another thing, the machines will not recognise ganger Jennifer because, well, she's a ganger. So she needs Rory to activate the machines for her. Are you kidding me? Are you really saying that in this factory, where they're surrounded by acid and dangerous equipment to the point where they need to inhabit ganger forms most of the time, their machines have not been designed to work with gangers? You know what? These people deserve to die if they're that stupid. You know what? I'm just gonna say it. This script was a first draft. There must have been no time to rewrite it, so Matthew Graham just submitted the first draft of the script, and the production just worked with this unpolished, unfocused script that completely messed up any hope of being effective or getting its message across, and is filled with enough plot holes to choke a basking shark.
Okay, so the script itself is an absolute mess, but what about the acting or the production aspect?
The acting from our main characters is pretty good, but that's to be expected. Matt Smith does a great job acting with himself, and some moments did genuinely make me wonder how they filmed some sequences. While normally the Matt Smith moments of the week would have been that throwback to Tom Baker, I don't think that really counts as a Matt Smith moment. So the moment of the week is near the end, as he orders Rory to step away from Amy and kills her. Just that entire sequence in the TARDIS is helmed with a great performance from Matt Smith. Amy and Rory also give good performances, and it is glad to see Rory in the spotlight in this two-parter. Too bad the whole aspect of Jennifer Ganger completely undermines his personal journey in this episode and makes it irrelevant. The supporting cast is all over the place in terms of performances. The performances range from bland, melodramatic, to just unenthusiastic. The actor who plays Miranda seems to be phoning her performance in. She just seems completely bored, and I don't even think she's acting. She seems very uninterested. I feel like the actor playing Jennifer is good, but here she is given such pretentious dialogue that you can't do anything with it.
The Cleves, the company, how could they do this? How could they?
Who are the real monsters?
How the hell can Rory not know that she's a ganger? She is practically giving herself away with every other word.
The dialogue just feels so forced and stilted that no matter how you read it, it will just feel like you're reading from a script. You know that speech Jennifer makes about the girl in the red wellies growing strong? That sounds like the blurb on the back of a book, not actual dialogue coming from a living creature. So all I can really say about the supporting cast for this two-parter is that while the performances weren't that great to begin with, the dialogue just kills it. The rest of the cast are so uncharacterised that they're not even worth mentioning. Seriously, these are the main characters in this 90-minute story that took 2 weeks to tell, and I don't care about any of them. But let's talk about the production. I said last week that the old style setting against the alien backdrop was effective, and it still is for the most part. However, many sequences take place in generic stone rooms and corridors, so the quality isn't very consistent throughout. The special effects though are pitiful, and while I know special effects are just a tool to tell a story, and that it's the script and the narrative we should be focusing on, bad special effects become a problem when they actually detract from the emotions the writer is trying to convey. Like I said earlier, that scene with Ganger Jennifer dying is absolutely hilarious because of the bad CGI. Also, what about the wide mouth? And just in case it couldn't get any sillier...
And I'm stronger, Buzz.
I'm a firing my laser!
The big blob of flesh just looks like a piece of 2D paper, and its concept doesn't even begin to make sense within the plot and what's been established. But I think I've beaten that aspect of the episode into the dirt by now, so I'll just let this die in peace. The eyes on the wall are also completely pointless, once again make no sense in terms of the plot and actually look kind of silly, and don't even get me started on the Jennifer monster. That scene with the ganger covered in makeup and breathing heavily, that was actually creepy, and one of the best moments of the episode, but then... out of nowhere, she just becomes another stereotypical monster from which the Doctor and his friends have to escape from. The monster looks awful, and I just hated the fact that the episode had to finish on that note. But let's talk about this two-parter as a whole. The Rebel Flesh was a very good setup, establishing characters, plot points, and gave us interesting ideas as to where the plot could go. While far from perfect, it was a solid start. The Almost People, however, seems to deliberately go out of its way to ignore everything that was established in part one. How could I put this another way? The Rebel Flesh started off as a normal ganger. Sure, it looks a bit off, but it still functioned well. The Almost People ended as a massive, messy flesh blob, just thrown away to rot in a corner and slowly decompose. However, while I can call the Almost People pretty much every insult under the sun, I can't really call it boring. I watched this episode with my friend Jamie, and we were just laughing at how stupid and bad many of the things were. So as far as I'm concerned, I can't call it worse television than Curse of the Black Spot, because that just bored me. Here, I was slightly engaged, but mainly because of how bad it was. The final score for The Rebel Flesh and The Almost People is a 4 out of 10. It started off pretty solid, but then The Almost People, well, to put it bluntly, cocked it up, but it didn't do it in an evolution of the Daleks kind of cocked up, in which the writer sort of had to work with what they'd already established. The vibe I got from this episode was that it was going out of its way to fuck up, and it seemed like Matthew Graham was deliberately trying to create shit and insult the audience. And you know what, Matthew? If that's what you were going for, you succeeded. With flying colours.
I understand that some people might like this episode, and if you do, that's fine, more power to you. But if you are going to compliment it, then actually talk about the episode and not just the final plot twist. Okay, I think I've said my piece on this, and this review's getting pretty long already. So, I'll see you next time, when a good man goes to war.
Trumpets!